At this time, we ask you to turn off your pagers, cell phones, or other electronic devices. The procedures for this public hearing are located in the lobby, along with the agenda and copies of the staff recommendations for today's hearing. Meeting schedules and agendas for the City Planning Commission are available online. Staff reports and maps for the City Planning Commission hearings will be available online approximately 1 week prior to the public hearing. To access this information, log on to www.norfolk.gov/planning. If you wish to speak on an item on today's agenda, you must fill out a request form with a staff member located in the council lobby. We normally hear items in the order in which they're listed on the agenda. The Planning Department staff will introduce each item by stating the type and purpose of the application and the location of the property. A staff member will deliver a presentation on each item, followed by a recommendation on each application to be considered at this hearing. Following the staff presentation, the commission will hear from proponents and then opponents, if there are any. Anyone who has signed in to speak will be called by the chair. He or she should approach the podium, state his or her name and mailing address. The speaker should speak directly to the commission and not to the audience. Remarks will be limited to 3 minutes each. However, the applicant's time will not be limited. After all the proponents and opponents have been heard, the commission will allow a rebuttal first from a proponents, then opponents. Total time for rebuttals are limited to 5 minutes each. At the conclusion of the hearing on each item, and after considering all information presented, the commission will take action on the matter. Action on each matter by the commission will be to recommend approval or denial by a majority vote. The statement of the motion in the affirmative by a member of the staff is a matter of voting procedure and in no way indicates the recommendation of the staff or the consensus of the commission. Following the action by the commission on the matter, a written recommendation will be made to City Council, except for applications where the decision of the Planning Commission is final. Anyone who attends the commission public hearings for a specific item will be notified by the City Clerk's office of the date on which City Council will consider the application. However, it is a responsibility of each applicant to contact the City Clerk's office to confirm the hearing date and time of the City Council public hearing. Susan, please call the roll.
Austin?
Here.
Ms. Shelton?
Here.
Mr. Maven?
Here.
Mr. McGee?
Here.
Mr. Pendleton?
Here.
Ms. Sutter?
Here.
And Mr. Murphy?
I am here. We'll start with the continued agenda.
Okay. First, before taking up the items on today's agenda, we will consider the following requests for withdrawals and for continuances. The following item is being withdrawn from the January public hearing agenda. It's continued agenda item number 2, Kaylin Hammond for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit homestay at 8508 Culver Crest. So that's withdrawn. The next is a list of continuances. So the following items will be continued from the January public hearing agenda to the February 23rd, 2023 public hearing agenda. Continued item number 1, HM Enterprises for conditional use permit to operate recreational vehicle sales, rental and maintenance at 3302 Croft Street. Regular agenda item number 3, DePaul Villages LLC for a change of zoning from INC, Institutional Campus, to PD, Plan Development at 150 and 160 Kingsley Lane. Regular agenda item number 9, Yoshuyo Hoi for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit, vacation rental at 941 Hillside. And regular item number 10, Asian Fusion for a conditional use permit for a drive-through facility, large scale at 3607 North Military Highway. All continued until the February,
thank you, public hearing. Ms. Austin.
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye.
Okay, now on to the first item on the continued agenda. We have the Crooked Crab for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit, vacation rental, at 1124 Virgilina Avenue. The purpose of this request is to allow the two-bedroom single-family home to operate as a short-term rental. Russell?
All right. Sorry about that. So the first item on the agenda, this is for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental, vacation rental, and a two-bedroom single-family home on the north side of Virgilina Avenue between Warwick Avenue and Atlin Street in the Bayview neighborhood. A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which describes a coastal character district as an eclectic mix of housing types interspersed with neighborhood-scale commercial uses. This property is zoned single-family 10. All short-term rentals in this zone are required to have a conditional use permit to operate, regardless of the number of bedrooms they contain. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. The house was built in 1962 on a 7,600-square-foot lot. It is compliant with parking requirements, and the site already is in compliance with the required 20% tree canopy. So for other vacation rentals nearby, there are currently 22 vacation short-term rentals and 2 homestay short-term rentals for a total of 24 registered short-term rental parcels in a 1-mile radius. An additional 6 short-term rentals are pending. We're currently tracking 8 additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area. This property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there are currently 3 registered short-term rental parcels and an additional 1 pending short-term rental. We are currently tracking 2 additional non-registered short-term rentals. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 91.9% of parcels are residential. 0.6% or 24 of those are short-term rentals. 89.8% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential, and 2.6% or 3 of those are short-term rentals. If all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 1% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. Okay, so this is something new we've created this month. We are going to try and have it on here as long as there are numerous comments. We just feel like it's important to put those comments into context. So each dot that you see on this map represents 1 comment address. If multiple comments are received from 1 address, the comment is still included in the package. But it's not. But you'll only see the single point on the map. If any comments were received after the map was made, you'll find that noted on the comment spreadsheet, also included in the packet. So here you can see the share of the 37 total comments we received on this application that were from within 1 mile and 500 feet. So before we get into this recommendation, we want to note that this application was continued from last month due to some concern the applicant did not meet the requirements for their Civic League notification. After further review and discussion with the Civic League's representative, we have determined that the concern was valid and directed the applicant to make contact with Civic League again. After their January 9th meeting, the Bayview Civic League Executive Board indicated that they met with the applicant to their satisfaction and do not oppose the application. So staff is recommending approval subject to the conditions. Standard conditions include having their emergency contact information provided inside and outside the property, maintaining a 20-minute response time, 24/7. Remote entry, security cameras, noise monitors, and private trash pickup. This conditional use permit will expire in 2 years.
Thank you, Russell. Mm-hmm. Any questions for Russell, commissioners? Please stand by. We have the applicant representative who signed up to speak, Mike Collins.
Good afternoon. My name is Michael Collins. My mailing address is 940 Corporate Lane, Chesapeake, Virginia, 23320. I appreciate your time and consideration in this. Between myself and my wife, we have almost $300,000 on the line between the purchase of this property and the improvement of this property, which has included exterior repair, interior repair, mechanical repair, fencing, furnishings, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We have currently been operating as a mid and long-term rental on this property, and the reason we decided to get a short-term rental, we have gotten a lot of requests from HRBT contractors, nurses, et cetera, looking for short-term rentals to fill, you know, short-term job positions or requirements in this area. So unlike some other entities, we have sucked it up and gone the legal route as far as this is concerned, and I would appreciate your consideration and approval in this matter. Do you have any questions for me specifically?
Commissioners, any questions for the applicant?
Well, my question,
yes,
thank
ma'am.
You for coming down today.
Thank you for your time.
You'd mentioned you've gotten inquiries about nurses and other folks who stay a little longer than maybe a weekend. Are you saying that's your primary customer that you're considering?
Yes, absolutely. We are looking to provide short-term housing for professionals, engineers, nurses, government employees, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That is our target clientele, not so much the weekend beachgoers and stuff like that. They tend to be a lot easier to deal with and cause a lot less problems. And we have some friends that are also in the short-term rental business, and some of the stories that they've told us in cities like Richmond, Arlington, Virginia, and stuff like that. I don't want to do that to our neighbors. I don't want our neighbors to look at our property and you know, kind of scoff at it and go, you know, here we go again. You know, I've lived in Norfolk a long time. My primary residence is on Willoughby Spit, so I am 5 minutes away from that property, so response time would not be an issue. I've seen all the effort that has gone into Norfolk being improved in that area. Anyone that's been in Norfolk for a long time knows that Ocean View used to be kind of rough around the edges, and it is definitely moving in the right direction, and I, as a taxpayer, am appreciative of that. And we want to continue to encourage that and contribute to that. I enjoy living in Norfolk, and hopefully everything that we've invested into this, you will go ahead and approve this, and we can move forward with it. Like I say, we do have a lot of money wrapped up in this, and I'm not a rich man. My wife is not a rich woman. This is just something that we've tried to do to try to diversify and secure our retirement portfolio.
Thank you for that. And one last question from,
yes, ma'am.
From me, anyway. How are you going to go about, I guess, customers finding you? Is this going to be an online?
Yes, ma'am. Our listings are actually through the MLS, because my wife is actually a licensed real estate agent, site called Furnished Finders, and then, of course, the regular Airbnb. And the Furnished Finders is the one that we seem to get the most action out of as far as request for service is concerned. And again, the people that are using Furnished Finders, they're traveling with their pets, which is one thing. This property is somewhat pet friendly. A lot of people, they don't want to leave their dogs at home when they're traveling out of town. We get a lot of traction out of that, and it provides a service because people don't necessarily want to stay in a hotel. They want to stay somewhere where they can have a kitchen with a coffee maker and a stove and a refrigerator and you know, all the cooking utensils and pots and pans and things like that, and we provide all of that and linen service and everything else. And I've actually stayed there myself just to be a conscious business owner and to check the property out, make sure everything functions the way it's supposed to, HVAC, and that everything in the kitchen works the way it's supposed to. And I got to say, I'm actually kind of impressed with myself and my wife for actually being able to pull this together and make it a viable thing. It's taken a lot. It's not easy. No one snapped their fingers and said, hey, we've got a property here. We actually had to bust our butts to make it happen. So here we are. We're kind of at the final hurdle. It would, like I say, we've been operating midterm. We've had a few clients, but we've had a lot of requests for short term that would really fill the gap and make it to where we're actually doing more than just able to pay the mortgage and the utilities and insurance for this property. So that's where we're at.
Great. Any other questions? Yes.
You are managing this yourself?
Yes, ma'am.
You're not living on the property?
No, ma'am. Okay. I live about 5 minutes away.
Collins, the address you gave Chesapeake, is that your business?
That's correct. That is where our main business office is located at. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And we do operate rental properties in Norfolk, Hampton, Richmond, and we're also working on one in Gloucester right now. So, and that's what we're trying to do to set ourselves up for retirement.
Excellent.
These are properties you manage, your own, all these other properties?
Yes, ma'am.
You own these properties?
Yes, ma'am.
And you manage them?
That's correct.
Thank
yep.
you.
Great. Please stand by. We have one other person signed up in support of this application as the applicant representative, but does not wish to speak. Kelly Dairam. Hi.
Hi. I'm shy.
Okay. Thank you for coming. We have one opponent signed up to speak, Aradia Robertson.
Thank you.
Hi, Aradia Robertson, 9620 20th Bay Street. I do oppose short-term rentals. As you know, I'm here quite often trying to oppose them. And I'm very thankful for Russell for also putting together things like this spreadsheet and also going and trying to map them as well. So thank you, Russell, for that. One thing I wanted to point out is on the list of support that they have, several people that are on this list of support are currently going through the STR process. Some are on the agenda today. And there's also, and they're using their local addresses here. For instance, Chris Dees is a Durham, North Carolina resident who's on the agenda today and using the Pleasant Avenue address. Chris Wheelis is also using the Garfield Drive address. And there's one that's on here that Christian Heckathorn, which is using the 1124 Virgilina Avenue. So I'm not sure how they can support it and live in it, have that be their address, and then also have it be STR'd. So, but I just wanted to voice my opposition. Thank you.
Thank you. We now enter the rebuttal period. Mr. Collins, do you have anything that you would like to add? And you're limited to 5 minutes.
Yes, sir. I will not take your valuable time. The question of the short-term rental and general and her opposition to it, I can understand that. We are not here to create disturbances in the neighborhood, to let people throw wild parties in our houses and stuff like that. We've worked way too hard for that. The gentleman that she questioned, Christian Heckathorn, he was actually one of our 45-day rentals that left early, and I thought this might come up, and I thought you guys might find this a little bit on the interesting side. The reason he left, and I'm not fancy, I can't put it up here, but you can pass this around. The images there are from one of my security cameras. That's required by code. And the pickup truck in that picture is Mr. Heckathorn's. Mr. Heckathorn immediately after the incident in that picture contacted my wife and said he's out. He's not living somewhere where there are people having fist fights in the front yard. He does support us in that. He does support us in the short-term rental process, but he actually bailed out and left himself because he felt unsafe. He was concerned that he was going to have property damage or something like that. So I just thought you might find that interesting, possibly almost fascinating that that would happen. And that is from a unit a couple buildings down from us that has now, those tenants have apparently been placed on probation by their landlord. So, yeah, that's about all I've got to say about that. And our property is not going to create disturbances in the neighborhood like that. And we maintain pretty tight control of it as far as the maintenance is concerned and as far as the behavior of the tenants is concerned. Like I stated earlier, I have no interest in getting phone calls from the city, from the police department, from the neighbors, saying that anything like that is going on, and then my tenants are the cause of it. And I have absolutely no problem throwing somebody out if they cause a problem with one of our properties. So, thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Robinson, you have 5 minutes rebuttal if you'd like to use it. Thank you. Commissioners, any comments or questions? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Yeah, I'll just add, Mr. Collins, you know, I'm sure you know the requirements for turning over a short-term rental are going to be much different than the longer-term rentals. And also, you're on if you're out at other cities. Be pretty close to be able to respond. So I'm I'll say yes, but I hope you pull it off.
That is actually a great question, and we do actually have a couple of friends in the area that have said if we need them, they will go ahead and take care of it.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Sarah?
Aye.
But I will make that recommendation to City Council. Good luck. Item four.
Is an item by Christopher Wheelis II for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit, vacation rental, at 1624 Garfield Drive. The purpose of this request is to allow the four-bedroom single-family home to operate as a short-term rental.
Susan, can you make sure you use your microphone?
All right. As Susan mentioned, this is for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental, vacation rental, in a four-bedroom single-family home on the north side of Garfield Drive, between Grove Avenue and Portal Road in the Bayview neighborhood. A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates the site as single-family suburban. The property is zoned single-family. Property is zoned single-family 6. All short-term rentals in this zone with more than three bedrooms are required to have a conditional use permit to operate. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. The house was built in 1955 on a 7,800 square foot lot. It is compliant with parking requirements via the driveway and the garage, and the applicant will be adding a backyard tree to come into compliance with the required 20% tree canopy. So for other vacation rentals nearby, there are currently 26 vacation short-term rentals and two homestay short-term rentals for a total of 28 registered short-term rental parcels in a 1 mile radius. An additional 11 are pending, and we are tracking 5 additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area. This property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there are no short-term rentals of any type, registered or otherwise. The closest short-term rental is over 1,000 feet away. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 95% of parcels are residential, and 0.5%, or 28 of those, are short-term rentals. 100% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential, and none of those are short-term rentals. If all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 0.8% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. So here you can see the share of the comments we received on this application that were within 1 mile and 500 feet. We received 47 comments from 43 individuals. Before we get into the recommendation, this one also has a note. This one was continued from last month due to concern that the applicant did not meet the requirements for their Civic League notification. After further review and discussion with the Civic League's representative, we determined the concern was valid and we directed the applicant to make contact with them again. After their January 9th meeting, the Bayview Civic League Executive Board indicated that they met with the applicant to their satisfaction and do not oppose the application. So staff is recommending approval subject to the conditions. Standard conditions include having the emergency contact information provided inside and outside the property, maintaining a 20-minute response time 24/7, remote entry, security cameras, noise monitors, and private trash pickup. And additional conditions would include planting a large tree in the rear yard and making modifications to the garage in order to accommodate the parking space. And this conditional use permit will expire in 2 years. Questions?
Commissioners, questions for Russell?
Yes, I have a question, which I should have asked earlier. Mm-hmm. On the previous map that you made, mm-hmm. you have the red, which is opposition?
Yes, ma'am.
And the numbers you gave do not correspond to the numbers of symbols that you have. Therefore, what is the equation? What do they represent?
So the only ones that are shown on there are the ones in those radius. There's a number of them that are either outside, or there's a number of them that where we get two people that share an address that make a comment, and it counts as two individuals, two comments, but it's only going to show up as one dot.
So that's essentially showing the location of the complaints, not necessarily the number of complaints.
Of the comments, yes.
Yeah, okay, the comments.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Great. Any other questions? Please stand by. Thanks, Russell.
Sure.
The applicant's representative is here to speak in favor of the application. Christopher Wheelis II. Name and address, please. Thanks.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me. My name is Christopher Wheelis, and my mailing address is 7945 Merritt Street, Norfolk, Virginia, 23518. And I'm the applicant for 1624 Garfield Drive. So I bought this property to, I wanted a place for friends and family to come stay while they come up and visit me and my wife here in Virginia. And I wanted to open this up as a short-term rental. For main reason is to provide some income for, you know, to help support the mortgage payment. But that being said, I do understand all the concerns my neighbors have on this as a short-term or any rental property. I do understand. I take them to heart, especially the ones closest to me around the house. So I want to say my number one priority with this property is to properly vet tenants and to allow only quality tenants to stay at the property. So I think I could accomplish that by doing, you know, following the city's guidelines they have, by having cameras on the property, by having, you know, my name, my contact information outside the property, by having noise decibel meters in the home, as well as my own systems for vetting the tenants to stay at the property. So it'll primarily be on Airbnb, and on Airbnb there's ways to, you know, check the guest. Each guest has a rating on there. I can approve or deny guests with bad ratings. I can ask their intentions with the property. But the bottom line here is I want my neighbors to know that I genuinely care about your concerns. And, you know, I want you to see that I live right down the street from you guys. You know, response time isn't an issue for me. I just want my neighbors to know that I ask for a little bit of faith in me as an owner, that I am looking out for your best interests. And I'm willing to take any corrective action I need to address any issues along the way. So.
Would this be your only short-term rental?
Yes, sir, my only short-term rental.
Thank you. Any other questions for the applicant?
So you are self-managing this as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Great, please stand by. Thanks. Signed up in support of this application but does not wish to speak is Kathy Powers. Says proponent. I'll move this over to the other side then. So we have no one else signed up in support of this application. We do have opponents of the application. When I call your name, please come up. You'll have 3 minutes. Give us your name and mailing address. Caitlin Greer.
Hello, my name is Caitlin Gear and I reside at 1623 Ayres Street. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak to you all today. I oppose the conditional use permit for a short-term rental at 1624 Garfield Drive for a multitude of reasons, and I'd just like to start at the beginning of that. When I received a letter from the city in December stating the application was going for approval for the house directly behind me, my heart sank. I quickly started doing research to find out how the permit got so far in the process without any prior knowledge. I was able to find the application in December agenda packet and immediately saw false information being provided. The applicant stated that the Bayview Civic League had no remarks for his request and provided information where he was in attendance of a few Civic League meetings. I then reached out to the Bayview Civic League to confirm the application and that the applicant had stated his intentions in at the property of Garfield, which they had no knowledge of. I then alerted my neighbors as to what was transpiring and asked them to email in their opposition to this permit, which we have the number for. We are a close-knit neighborhood where we all very well know one another and have looked out for each other for many years. There are major concerns around introducing a short-term rental into our quiet neighborhood. Some of these concerns are unnecessary comings and goings of strangers, parking issues, our area being treated poorly, loud party, as well as a drastic change in our dynamic and our charm. I bought my house on Ayres Street 7 years ago utilizing a city grant. The grant stipulations are that the home must remain owner-occupied for at least 10 years. I understand that this may be a HUD requirement. However, I think that the city would not have adopted a program and provided first-time home buyers a down payment of $40,000 if owner occupancy wasn't something they wanted for the city. The allowance of short-term rentals seemed to totally negate this initiative. When I was searching for my home, I intentionally did not entertain any properties close to apartments or duplexes because I did not want rotating neighbors. I wanted to live in a neighborhood where I could get to know my neighbors and form relationships, which so far has happened. So much so, the neighbors who previously owned Garfield, 1624 Garfield, installed a gate when putting up a privacy fence so we could have easy access to each other when sharing vegetables from our gardens or having our dogs play. Now this gate is a huge safety concern for me. I'm not only worried about the here and nows of this short-term rental, but I'm concerned about the families and future generations who have the dream of becoming homeowners like myself, but will not be able to compete with investors who have the means to purchase homes way over their worth. I've talked to numerous people about the rising issues of short-term rentals, specifically in Ocean View. I heard from a sailor who was stationed here how hard it was for him to find a decent place to rent, and heard the same grievances from another friend who moved their mom here from Baltimore. During this month's Civic League meeting that Andrea and Jeremy attended, one neighbor asked, what are some benefits for a short-term rental? We received only one response, and that was revenue to the city. So besides revenue to the city and to the applicant, what are some benefits for the neighbors who live in close proximity? I can't think of any either.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Also signed up to speak in opposition of this application is Joan Ernest.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
My name is Joan Ernest. I live at 1622 Garfield Drive. My parents purchased this home in 1955 when it was brand new. I have inherited my family home. I've lived there since 2008. There are 16 homes on the block, 15 of them, only one rental on the whole block. Average age is about 65 on that block. So we have, my concern is having people in and out. The noise level, of course, you have the noise thing, which is supposed to help. But my concern is having parking issues and just the community that we have. I mean, we know all the neighbors. Caitlin lives right directly behind me. We talk over back and forth. And I just can't see having someone there just to be in and out, you know, one weekend here, one week here. There was a bad incident at 1624 last March where there was a shooting and there were two young men that were injured by the homeowner. They are still traumatized, and if a strange car pulls up, both of them, one of them my grandson and the other one a boy across the street, that they get anxious, they're still anxious. And the idea of having people, strange people in and out, isn't my concern for them. Because one of the boys was 22 and he was shot and almost didn't survive. He is getting his colostomy reversed this week, a year later. So I appreciate everybody listening to me and I just wanna have my opposition. Nothing against Chris, but we just wanna keep our neighborhood a neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Also signed up to speak out against this application, Aradia Robertson.
Aradia Robertson, 9620 20th Bay Street. Again, I'd like to thank Russell for putting all of this together. I really want to congratulate the neighborhood because they have put so much into opposing this to keep their neighborhood an actual neighborhood. They've done a great job. Mr. Wheelis it's my understanding he was also at the Civic League meeting, which I was invited by some of the residents to attend. He did have the opportunity when the neighbors were voicing their opinions to their Civic League leader that he did have the opportunity to actually address some of these concerns, and he did not. There are also concerns about shortcutting the process by not having a neighborhood meeting and just asking for attendance from the Civic League. And with the support too, there's also two people that are on the support that are on the agenda for today. It seems like all the STR owners are, of course, in support of each other, but there's no local support for this on this in this neighborhood in the street. So the neighbors have done a great job of opposing it, and I congratulate them for doing that. I haven't seen this much opposition since the one on 17th Bay. Thank you.
Thank you. We have several people who signed up in opposition of this application who do not wish to speak. Laura M. Reese, Ellen M. Miller, James A. Miller, Michael Reese, we have an opponent I do not wish to speak, but undecided also. Cheryl D. Davis. And Kathy Powers. Thank you all for coming downtown. So we will now enter the rebuttal period. Mr. Willis, you have 5 minutes to address any of the concerns that were expressed.
Thank you. I appreciate hearing all the concerns with all my neighbors. And honestly, this many concerns just gives me, you know, affirmation that I need to take, you know, further care of making sure this property doesn't affect the neighborhood negatively. To address the application procedure process, so I'm trying to take every step here that I can, just going down the list. And I'm in the military. I live by procedure. So I believe it's step three. It says meet with the Civic League, or attend a Civic League meeting. And that's exactly what I did. And I thought, you know, that met the requirement. I was later informed by the planning department that I needed to meet with the Civic League board, the executive board, to discuss the application. And that's what I did. And I'll gladly do anything else I need to get this process done correctly. So I attended the Civic League meeting. I attended multiple meetings as a member. I joined as a member, and I'll continue to be there. So I was at the Civic League meeting the other day when people were voicing their concerns, and I was sitting in the back, and I honestly didn't expect this much opposition, and I want you to know that I genuinely care about my neighbors' concerns, and it was kind of nerve-wracking to speak up at that meeting, because it was a lot of bashing of the owner, and I understand the reasons why, but I was there, and I heard everything, and I just asked my neighbors to have a little faith in me. I know I can't say anything here to change your minds on short-term rentals, but I just ask for a little faith in me as the owner. Thank you.
Thank you. So the opponents now have collectively 5 minutes to respond to the applicant. So of the three individuals who spoke, Ms. Ernest, Ms. Greer, and Ms. Robertson, collectively you have 5 minutes to respond if you would like to.
Mr. Wheelis had mentioned that he was military and he's also self-managing. How is he going to be able to manage it and respond when he is deployed, depending on what branch of service he is, if he's out to sea? He also made a comment of he wanted to properly vet people. I'd like to know how you properly vet people in an STR, because I've had some horrific experiences that I want to know how they were vetted to. Another thing that came up is, like many of the other homes in Ocean View, it's also my understanding that he paid over the asking price for the home as well, which is negatively inflating all of our home prices too.
Thank you. Does anyone else wish to speak? Ms. Greer, thank you.
Thank you. So the last thing I wanted to mention is our executive board for our Civic League. They discussed and voted on this matter without any input from the neighbors, even after we asked to be involved in this process. Their recommendation to move forward is based on their own thoughts and feelings about short-term rentals and not those who will be directly impacted. As Mr. Wheelis had said, he was at the Civic League meeting and chose not to stand up and introduce himself. I've never met him. I've never been informed of what his intentions are and what he is planning to do to keep our neighborhood as our neighborhood. So I feel as if that were approached differently, I may not be here today. However, I feel like people are trying to take advantage of our area, and it's just very unsettling for me. So I am strongly asking the city to reconsider not only this application, but all applications going forward for short-term rentals, and understand the impact it is having and will continue to have on our community. And I leave you with one final question to ask you all, if you guys would like to live next door to a short-term rental. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I did not understand.
I'm sorry, I wanted to ask you all if you guys wanted to live next door to a short-term rental, if that's something that you would want for as your neighbor and neighborhood. Just something to contemplate. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Ernest, are you going to add anything?
Yes, sir.
Great, thank you very much. All right, commissioners, that closes the rebuttal period. Any comments or questions?
I have a question. I'm sorry.
Jump right in.
Oh, I have a question of Mr. Wheelis. If we could find out when the property was purchased.
sorry.
You can come back up to the podium, please. Sorry.
The property purchased in September, ma'am.
That was from her. It's okay. She's got one, too.
It's okay. She's got one, too, so you can stay there and she'll...
Yeah, I have not heard before about the grant to first-time homeowners being brought up in terms of short-term rentals, and if that is somehow conflicting here with the notion of home occupancy and how that is defined. I think it's Ms. Ernest. Is Ms. Ernest?
Yes, I think that. I'm sorry. The public comment period's over. I think the comp plan is our guiding principle in land use decisions. We can be aware of what the HUD program is, mm-hmm. but what should be driving our decisions is a comp plan.
Okay. All right. Gotcha.
Any other questions?
I have a question for Mr. Wheelis. So, Mr. Wheelis, you have a number of residents or neighbors that are close by that are here that are expressing some concerns. Up until today, have you had any dialogue directly with any of those? And if so, what's been the result of those conversations?
So I think it was a couple months ago I'd spoken to her name is Nana. She lives right next door to me. It's a nice lady, just, you know, casual talk. That's not too much. That's about it.
Yeah. So one of the seven you've talked with, is that correct?
Seven
opposed that are close by?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Wheelis, do you have any other property that you manage or have any experience managing rental properties?
So I have three other rental properties around Norfolk.
Okay.
I do have a property manager for those properties. They're long-term tenants.
Okay. Is there any consideration for having a professional manage this particular, because short-term rentals obviously are much different than long-term rentals.
Right.
And so if you don't get this approved, what is your plan?
So my plan was to manage myself as a short-term rental. If it becomes anything more than I can handle, then I'd be glad to look into getting a property manager for professional experience. And I'm in the Navy Reserve, so I do have time to do this. I go in for drill once a weekend, a month.
And on those weekends, you have someone else covering?
Yes, sir.
You are making this a short-term rental versus your other long-term rental properties?
Yes, ma'am.
And the reason for that, for that decision?
So I wanted a place, a nice place for my family and friends to stay, to have that option when they come visit me and my wife from Georgia. And as a short-term rental, I could have certain times open for people to come, my friends and family to stay at when they need to. So just to have that option available.
Commissioners, any other questions or comments? Thanks. Susan?
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the
staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
No.
Mr. Bateman?
No.
Mr. McGee?
No.
Mr. Pendleton?
Due to potential conflict of interest, I have to abstain for this vote.
Ms. Sarath?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. That's 3-3. What is the recommendation of City Council?
We would just tell them that you had a tie vote and forward that recommendation.
Great, so we won't be recommending approval or denial. Thank you very much for coming downtown. We'll move on to the next application.
The next item is Ready to Roll Motorsports for the following conditional use permits at 3345 North Military Highway to operate A, an automobile sales and service establishment, and B, tire sales and repair. The purpose of this request is to allow automobile sales and tire sales.
Thank you, Susan. This site is located on the south side of North Military Highway between Ferris Street and Azalea Garden Road. The proposed use is consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates this site as commercial. It is currently zoned CC, and as discussed, the conditional permits for automobile sales and tire sales and repair. So a little bit of history on this property. This property is operated as either a vehicle sale, an automobile rental or tile sales location since 2001. Bud's Used Tires and Brake Service operated at this location most recently from July of 2016 to August of 2022. In October of 2017, Bud's obtained a special exception, now called a conditional use permit, to operate an automobile sales and service establishment. Bud's already had business licenses for automobile repair and for tire sales. But after they got the special exception, they did not obtain a new business license to sell automobiles. Without the new business license, previous special exception does not permit Ready to Roll Motorsports to sell automobiles at this location. So Ready to Roll Motorsports is now getting a new CUP that's going to cover both uses and have them both compliant with the ordinance at this time. So here we have the layout of the site. One of the things that staff worked with the applicant was making sure that there was enough parking for the customers who were going to be doing the vehicle sales and the customers who had to leave their cars for tire repair and sales and stuff like that, while also having room for automobiles to sell. So we worked with them to make the site plan so that there's certain spots dedicated for customers and certain spots dedicated for them to have vehicles for sale. Here's a picture of the site. The two vehicles in the front on the left side of your screen, those are parked in the right-of-way. We've discussed this issue with the applicant, and those vehicles have been removed, and he knows that he cannot park vehicles for sale there. They will only be parking locations specified on his site plan. Otherwise, you can see in the middle of the screen, there's a building in the front for the sales and transaction process. And then in the back, there's a three-bay tire facility for the tire repair and sale. Staff recommends the application be approved subject to the conditions in the staff report. The site is located along a commercial corridor with similar uses in the vicinity, and the proposed use is in keeping with the current operations on site. I did want to take a minute here to go over the performance standards for tire sales. Tires shall be stored either inside the principal structure or within an accessory structure. No tires shall be stored outdoors. No more than one accessory structure shall be utilized for tire storage. And said accessory structure shall be no larger than 25% of the floor area of the principal structure. Transportable portable storage units, shipping containers shall not be utilized for tire storage. That and the other standard conditions for automobile sales are included in the recommendation.
Thank you, Robert. Any questions for Robert? Please stand by. We have the applicant representative signed up to speak, Sullivan Callahan.
Good afternoon. I'm F. Sullivan Callahan. I'm an attorney. My address is 327 Duke Street, Norfolk, Virginia, 23510. I'm representing the applicant. As Robert has pointed out, this is a new application. What we want to do is what has been allowed at this site before, and that's to sell automobiles and tires and to repair those tires. And so with that, I really don't have a lot of other explanation unless you all have any questions.
Any questions? All right, please stand by in case any come up.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Also signed up in support of this application but does not wish to speak is Michael Anderson. Thank you very much. There's no opposition to this application. Commissioners, any comments? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. We'll make that the recommendation of City Council. Thank you very much.
On to our regular agenda. The first item is a request by the City Planning Commission for a zoning text amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance to clarify the requirements for a conditional use permit for the development of retail goods establishments of 50,000 square feet and larger.
Good afternoon. So as Susan said, this request is to amend the zoning ordinance to for the performance standards that apply to the retail use of retail goods establishment. So presently we have a standard that requires for any retail goods establishment that is larger than 50,000 square feet requires a conditional use permit for the development of that use. And so development in the zoning ordinance is a very broad term. It covers what you would think of as development, but it also covers change of use, demolition, a few other things like that. That was not the intent. the intent was construction of or substantial alteration of such a facility should require a conditional use permit, so we don't have new ones, you know, large facilities open when we're not aware of them. And so we want to make that correction, and that's really all we're doing here. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Great. Questions? Let's call the vote.
Zoning text amendment to the Norfolk zoning ordinance. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
And I probably should have mentioned no one signed up to speak on this item. I vote aye.
Next item, City Planning Commission for zoning text amendment to the Norfolk zoning ordinance to amend the performance standards for the production of craft beverages.
And I'll actually move the slides here since I clearly can't see the screen from here. So this item is, as Susan indicated, is an amendment to the performance standards for the use called production of craft beverages. So in lay terms, that might be a microbrewery, microdistillery, that type of business. When we created this use in 2018, we didn't get it right. We included a performance standard that specifically spoke to requiring those requiring that the only beverages sold on site were those that were produced on site. And that's not how the industry operates. That's not how the industry was operating in 2018. That's not how the industry is operating today. Obviously, we know breweries share and promote other products from other breweries. So that's something we want to just go ahead and remove from the ordinance. In addition, as we were going through this section, we found a couple of clerical errors we wanted to clean up. And that is what the proposal is, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
You mentioned beer. Does this cover beer and wine?
Yes. Beer, wine, and anything from a distillery as well.
Any questions, commissioners? No one signed up to speak on this item.
Craft beverage cidery?
Yes. Yes. Covers the full gamut.
Whole thing.
Excellent. Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the zoning text amendment to the Norfolk zoning ordinance. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council.
Thank you.
Okay. Item number four, the crossing for the following applications at 115 West 25th Street. A, for a rezoning to HO-NW Norfolk and Western Historic Overlay. There is a part B on here, a conditional use permit to operate a personnel services. That part of the application has been withdrawn. So this is the site here, 115 West 25th Street. It is on the southeast corner of West 25th Street between Omohundro and Granby. It is in an industrial area. And the request is to bring it into the Norfolk and Western Historic Overlay. It does comply with the Plan Norfolk 2030. Anytime we can get a contributing structure and save it and provide for an adaptive reuse, that is absolutely a goal of our Plan Norfolk 2030. So again, as I mentioned, the property is zoned IL, which is industrial light, and it is currently developed with uses that are permitted in that IL district. There's a restaurant, there's a tattoo parlor, and a yoga studio. The site is also located in a state and national historic district. It is the Norfolk and Western Railway historic district. What the applicant would like to do is rezone it and bring it into the Norfolk and Western Railway historic overlay district. That is a local historic district. So if you rezone the property, you bring it into that district. Any modifications to the exterior of the building would be reviewed through our architectural review board. That doesn't happen in a state and federal historic district, only in a local historic district. So in addition to requiring modifications to the exterior of the building to go through architectural review board, it may in the future also allow additional uses that are allowed in our commercial and residential districts. Not a part of this application. This application is purely to bring it into that local historic district overlay. The site, I think you've probably all seen it before. It has been through our architectural review board on numerous occasions for encroachments and signage. So the architectural review board is familiar, and they are glad to bring it into, like I said, that historic district because it is a contributing structure in that state district. Staff is recommending that the application be approved, getting it into the historic district, saving a contributing structure. That's a win-win for everyone, and staff is recommending that the application be approved.
Thank you. Any questions for Susan, commissioners? Please stand by. The applicant representative is here, Chris Johnson. Do you wish to speak?
I'm happy to answer any questions.
Hey. Is anybody going to have any questions? Save Chris a walk. All right. Thank you for coming. Any comments, commissioners? Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the rezoning. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye, and thanks for continuing to invest in Norfolk. Thank you. Have a nice drive back. Next item.
Item number 5358 at Freemason LLC for a renewal of a conditional use permit to operate short-term vacation rental at 358 West Freemason Street. The purpose of this request is to allow the multifamily apartment to renew the operation of a short-term rental.
All right. As Susan mentioned, this is for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental, vacation rental, in a two-unit condo on the northeast corner of West Freemason Street and Botetourt Street in the Freemason neighborhood. Under previous short-term rental regulations, the applicant obtained separate conditional use permits for each unit. The third floor unit was authorized by conditional use permit in November of 2020. This conditional use permit is now expired. The second unit, located in an accessory dwelling unit referred to as the summer kitchen, was authorized in July 2022. The purpose of this request will put both of those units into a single conditional use permit with uniform conditions and a single expiration date. A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates the site as downtown and describes this as a high-intensity blend of residential, retail, sales and services, hotel, office, institutional, and civic uses supporting a pedestrian-oriented environment. The property is zoned West Freemason Historic and Cultural Conservation. All short-term rentals here are required to have a conditional use permit to operate in the district. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. The house was built in 1890 on a 6,100 square foot lot. It was significantly renovated in 2020 when a health and fitness facility opened on the first and second floors. Parking requirements are met via on-street parking with additional parking available on adjacent lot, also controlled by the applicant. Due to site conditions, it is already in compliance with required tree canopy as much as practicable. When the commercial space was added, it was also brought into compliance with flood regulation. So for other vacation rentals nearby, there's currently two vacation short-term rentals, including this property, and two homestay short-term rentals for a total of four registered short-term rental parcels in a one-mile radius. No additional short-term rentals are pending, and we are currently tracking three additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area. This property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there are no other short-term rentals registered pending or unregistered. This is the only property within the 500 feet that's a short-term rental. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 62% of parcels are residential, 0.3% or four of those are short-term rentals. 57% of parcels within 500 feet are residential, and 1.6% of those, or a single parcel, is a short-term rental, and that's this one. If all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 0.6% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. I do not have a comment slide for this one, as there were no comments received. So staff recommends approval subject to the conditions. The standard conditions include having their contact information provided inside and outside of each unit, maintaining a 20-minute response time 24/7, remote entry, security cameras, noise monitors, and private trash pickup. Another change on this one is that due to the fact the applicant has been operating for over 2 years without any complaints from the community and no known negative impacts, we are therefore recommending that the expiration of the conditional use permit be extended from the standard 2 years to the allowable 5 years.
Thank you, Russell. Mm-hmm. Any questions for Russell? Please stand by.
All right.
Thank you. We have one person signed up to speak in support of the application. It's the applicant's representative, Patricia Letchworth.
I was just not here to speak, just to answer questions.
Great, thank you. We'll save you a walk, maybe. Any questions for the applicant? Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thanks for coming down.
Okay. Item number 6, Eastern Venture Investments for a renewal of a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental, vacation rental at 1976 East Ocean View Avenue. The purpose of this request is to allow the multifamily apartment to renew the operation of the short-term rental units.
All right, this is for the renewal of a conditional use permit for the operation of a short-term rental vacation rental in a multifamily apartment complex on the northwest corner of East Ocean View Avenue and Inlet Road in the Cottage Line neighborhood. The proposed use does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which describes the coastal character district as an eclectic mix of housing types interspersed with neighborhood-scale commercial uses. Property is zoned residential coastal. In this district, all short-term rentals with more than 3 dwelling units require a conditional use permit. So here we see the site of the short-term rental. Built in 1982, the building contains 8 units with 17 total bedrooms. The site is compliant with the required parking. Due to site conditions, the site is as close as practicable to the required 20% tree canopy coverage. As part of this application, the applicant will refresh the landscaping in the parking lot buffer. Pending specifics from our Environmental Bureau, the applicant will also remove invasive vines from the dune and replant dune grass as needed. The applicant will also be required to install a sprinkler system in the building in order to obtain a required new certificate of occupancy. And then if replaced during the duration of the conditional use permit, the applicant will be required to elevate HVAC mechanical equipment as to exceed the design flood elevation. So for other vacation rentals nearby, there's currently 36 vacation short-term rentals and 4 homestay short-term rentals for a total of 40 registered short-term rental parcels in a 1 mile radius. An additional 12 short-term rentals are pending, and we're tracking 8 more non-registered short-term rentals. This property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there are 3 vacation short-term rentals, 0 homestays, 0 pending, 0 non-registered short-term rentals. For the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 91% of the parcels are residential. 1.5% or 40 of those are short-term rentals. Roughly 93% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential. 3 of those are short-term rentals. If all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 1.9% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. Here you can see the share of comments we received in the application that were within the 1 mile and 500 feet. We only received 2 comments on this application. So staff is recommending approval subject to conditions. Standard conditions include having the emergency contact information provided inside and outside of each unit, maintaining a 20-minute response time 24/7, remote entry security cameras, noise monitors, and private trash pickups. The applicant will obtain a new certificate of occupancy, refresh the parking buffer landscaping, and remove invasives and replant the dune as necessary. HVAC mechanical will be elevated if the equipment requires replacement within the duration of the conditional use permit. Due to the significant investment in order to meet the conditional use permit requirements, the applicant is requesting the maximum 10-year conditional use permit expiration. Any questions?
Not from me. Commissioners, any questions?
I have a point of clarification. Russell, your staff report does mention the 8-unit building that's improved there, which you mentioned in your presentation. But then it also says you've computed the parking based on 3 one-bedroom units and 7 two-bedroom units, so that would be 10 units. So I'm not sure which is the correct.
The second portion is likely the incorrect portion.
Okay.
There's 8 units.
All right, definitely 8. Okay, so yep. Then just make a note that that probably needs to be corrected before it goes to council.
Okay.
Thank you, Adam. Commissioners, any questions or comments? Great. We have one speaker signed up. Please stand by. Thank you. In support of this application, it's the applicant's representative, Heath Henneveld. Just a reminder, state your name and address.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Lieutenant Commander Heath Henneveld. I'm an active duty SEAL officer down in Damneck, Virginia, and my address is 1013 Bay County Drive, Virginia Beach, Virginia. Russell did a great job of reiterating all those points. I'll hit a few key points just to nail home. This is a renewal. We've been operating successfully since 2021. Since I've owned the property in 2020, we've done massive improvements, interior and exterior alike. We've updated and installed a ton of safety, security, remote monitoring systems, and we did that all prior to the city requiring that. So we were trying to be professional about this operation from the get-go, whether it was required by the city or not. And then this is under professional management via Tesseract as well. I have a few other notes here, but I think Russell hit them all in the intro, so pending any questions.
Commissioners, any questions for the applicant? Great, please stand by. Thanks.
Thank you.
Comments, Commissioner? Any discussion? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Thanks for coming to City Hall today.
Okay. Item number 7, Chris Dees for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental unit, vacation rental, at 2701 Pleasant Avenue. The purpose of this request is to allow the single-family home to operate as a short-term rental unit.
All right. This is for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental vacation rental in a four-bedroom single-family home on the southeast corner of Pleasant Avenue and 7th Bay Street in the East Ocean View neighborhood. A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which describes Coastal Character District as an eclectic mix of housing types interspersed with neighborhood-scale commercial uses. Property is zoned residential coastal. All short-term rentals in this zone with more than three bedrooms are required to have a conditional use permit to operate. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. The house was built in 2022 on a 6,000 square foot lot. It is compliant with parking requirements, and the site is already in compliance with required 20% tree canopy. The applicant will be installing a 5-foot wide concrete sidewalk to connect the landing under the front steps directly to the city sidewalk. For other vacation rentals nearby, there are currently 52 vacation short-term rentals, 7 homestay short-term rentals, for a total of 59 registered short-term rental parcels in a 1-mile radius. An additional 18 short-term rentals are pending. We're currently tracking 9 additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area, but this property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. Within 500 feet, there are only 2 vacation short-term rentals, 2 homestay short-term rentals, and 1 pending short-term rental. There are no non-registered short-term rentals within 500 feet. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 89% of parcels are residential, 1.8% or 59 of those are short-term rentals, 85.2% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential, and 3.8% or 4 of those are short-term rentals. If all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 2.4% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. So here you can see the share of comments we received on this application that were from within 1 mile and 500 feet. We received in total 15 comments on this application from 14 different individuals. Before I get to the recommendation, I'd like to note that this one was delayed a month due to concern raised by neighbors that the applicant did not meet the requirements for their neighborhood meeting. After further review, we determined that while the applicant likely met the technical requirements of the ordinance, the concerns were still reasonable, and the applicant agreed to host a second neighborhood meeting. So staff is recommending approval subject to conditions. Standard conditions include having emergency contact information provided inside and outside of the property, maintaining a 20-minute response time 24/7, remote entry, security cameras, noise monitors, and private trash pickup. The applicant will install the required sidewalk, and that is an error on the last one there. The conditional use permit will expire in 2 years.
Thank you, Russell. Any questions for Russell, commissioners? Please stand by. The applicant is here and signed up to speak, Chris Dees. Hi.
Hello. Thank you guys for your time today. I have prepared a statement just to give you guys a little bit of history about myself and plans for the property. And my mailing address is 2701 Pleasant Avenue. My journey to pursuing a short-term rental property began when my mother, Sheila Ann White, passed away unexpectedly last year. I was born in Hampton Roads, and my mother and father's families lived throughout Hampton and Norfolk. The loss of one of the closest people in my life gave me a desire to connect and be closer to loved ones. In deciding where to purchase a rental property that my family could also utilize during our visits to the area, the city of Norfolk was particularly appealing to me because of the clear guidelines outlined in the short-term rental ordinance that specify the criteria and process for legally operating a permitted rental. This is a passion project for me, and it has personal significance. But I am also an experienced real estate professional and have done a lot of preparation to be able to manage my properties successfully. I've held a real estate license for over 9 years and have been managing my own properties for over 12 years. I also took a 6-month course on short-term rental management through my brokerage last year. I have established a local team to assist with the property. My property assistant, Hannah Ribbis, lives within walking distance from the home and often visits the property multiple times during the week and drives by it daily. She's been assisting me with property setup and is available to respond on site to any issues that arise. My maintenance manager, Andy S. Miller, is a licensed Virginia realtor and manages 15 properties in the area. He lives less than 10 minutes away from the home and is also available to respond to any issues. During my public meetings with the community, I learned that 3 of the top concerns neighbors have regarding short-term rentals are noise, trash, and parking. In response to this feedback, I have joined the Rent Responsibly community, a community building and education platform that helps short-term rental operators partner with their communities to be good neighbors and positive contributors to the community. I've proactively outlined a plan for noise, trash, and parking management to ensure my home does not contribute to these issues. Another concern related to short-term rental homes are that the homes become party homes, and I've outlined a multi-pronged approach for ensuring that parties do not take place at my property. My ideal renters are guests are families, professionals, government workers, and military travelers seeking 2-week to 3-month stays. To this end, I have contracted my property with the company At Ease Rental Corporation. This company serves active service members and their families, government employees, and government contractors by providing them with government-approved short-term rental properties for temporary lodging. They have already inspected my property and confirmed it will pass government inspection for this use and plan to begin utilizing my property once my permit is approved. I have also listed my property with AIL Property Solutions, a company that works with insurance companies to place families in temporary housing that have been displaced due to fire, natural disaster, or other catastrophes. These are 2 examples of the many avenues I plan to pursue to attract professional and corporate renters. I know that there are some members of the community that oppose short-term rentals and use the conditional use permitting process to express their frustrations. All of the specific examples of challenges that have been voiced to me involve long-term rentals or unregistered STRs. A search of the data mining website AirDNA reveals 770 active STR listings in the city of Norfolk, while the Norfolk government website shows 231 permits in place. I would argue that people like myself who are attempting to go through the proper channels and regulations are not the individuals they should be fighting. Simply put, I intend to be a good neighbor, responsible citizen, and attentive property manager. I hope the Planning Commission will support my application and send a message to those choosing to skirt the process that it is possible to follow the ordained procedures and operate within the City of Norfolk's guidelines. I'd like to end by saying that owning this property has afforded my family with opportunities we would not have had otherwise. Myself, my husband, and my 2 children were able to spend time with my family over the holidays in our Norfolk home. I've been able to visit the area and see family multiple times over the past couple of months without having to rent someone else's property. Finally, we hope to have a 1-year remembrance ceremony for my mom at this home this year. These things will only continue to be possible if we're able to sustain the property financially using the short-term rental income generated during the times we're not using the property. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Any questions from Ms. Dees? Please stand by. Thank you very much. Here in support of the application but does not wish to speak, Dr. Eldrin Dees. Thank you. Those are the people who signed up in support. In opposition, we have Aradia Robertson.
Aradia Robertson, 9620 20th Bay Street. I was invited to the neighborhood meetings by the neighbors that were located around this. And I want to say that hosting the neighborhood meetings don't work. Ms. Dees was actually, I would say, close to verbally attacked by a lot of the neighbors, as was Mr. and Mrs. Broom. They don't work. There's no one to mediate them. It just doesn't get anywhere. Ms. Dees did conduct another meeting as well, but in her presentation, she said her target audience was 1 to 6 months, which she said in both meetings. As long as I've been coming here, there's been a lot of concern about new builds being bought up by people from out of the area to turn into short-term rentals. This is also another case. Ms. Dees is from Durham, North Carolina. She plans to self-manage this with a helper, is what she said in both of her presentations. The helper does not have any kind of property management or real estate training. And my biggest question was, if you have problems, how are they going to be able to get them out without any training whatsoever? And the other thing that was also brought up during the meetings is that she does intend to rent to locals. A lot of the more successful STR operators will not rent to locals because that's where a lot of the major parties will start happening. So that's just what I wanted to say about this. Thank you.
Great, thank you. No one else signed up to speak against this application, so we'll enter the rebuttal period. 5 minutes for proponents and then 5 minutes for opponents. So Ms. Dees, if there's anything like you'd like to add, you've got 5 minutes.
Just a quick point of clarification. Both of the people that I've hired onto my team do have real estate experience. One is actually a licensed realtor and property manager in the area, and I'm not certain what point that Ms. Robertson was making about renting to locals, but at that part of the meeting, I was explaining how I'll prevent against parties happening, and I was explaining that a lot of times you have to be careful when there are individuals seeking to rent your home who live in the area for just one night, and you want to do careful vetting. So I wasn't saying like I will or won't rent to locals. I was just explaining that I know what it takes to make sure parties aren't happening at the house.
Great, thank you. Ms. Robertson, would you like to take advantage of the 5 minutes? Okay, thank you very much. So that's everyone who has signed up to speak and the rebuttal period. Commissioners, any comments?
I'm impressed with the fact that there are people within the city, neighbors, who come here consistently to give their opinion about what is going on. That is extremely commendable, both for and against anything that has been put forward here. It appears that we are beginning to really develop a communication that is very positive. Sometimes we have real contradictions in what is being put forward, and it is really it ameliorates the issue when there's conversation that clarifies all of this. Now, there was just hinted that there was some intense communication at this meeting, and I for one would like some clarification about what that was, because that is important and it shouldn't be glossed over.
Well, so the applicants are required to have a public meeting, a community meeting, if the Civic League doesn't want to host a meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that was the reference, was this the community meeting that the applicant organized. And staff has criteria for those meetings, although those meetings are not necessarily attended by staff and not administered by anyone other than the applicant. And so it just sounded like we had a couple of unpleasant participants. And that's essentially what happened. Is that a fair characterization? And if it's not, please step up to the mic.
I think you got it pretty well. I will say that one thing that's very challenging about those community meetings is that there isn't a, like this meeting, there's a defined structure. Like you, it's this person's time to talk. That doesn't happen at the community meetings, and especially as like an applicant coming in and dealing with the public, it can be a little stressful and challenging. I'm not sure what Ms. Robertson experienced, but you can imagine emotions are running high on both for the applicant and for the people who are coming. So I think that's what she's referring to. I will say that I've heard stories from other applicants about their meetings, and I will say my meeting actually went pretty smooth compared to the stories that I've heard, but it was very stressful, and I was a little unprepared for the emotion and the need to actually kind of control the meeting.
Thank you very much. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. Any comments from commissioners? And I'll add to the public meetings. We require that in addition to the meetings that the formal meetings because we take this so seriously. And I apologize that it's not perfect, but by the time we get to a public hearing, Planning Commission has reviewed applications from presentations from staff three times. So this is the third or fourth time when we're in this room that we hear the presentation. We've gone on field trips out to the neighborhoods to look at the applicants' addresses. And this is in addition to the community meetings and the Civic League meetings. So we're vetting these applications as thoroughly as we can because we take this so seriously. And if the process isn't perfect, I think all of us would acknowledge that, but it's not for a lack of effort to give everyone in the public the opportunity to be aware of what's happening and to provide comment. Any comments before we take the vote?
Yeah, one more.
Yes.
Sorry. Could staff clarify the time, the stay that's considered short-term rentals? Because we got various times here, and it should be clear for everyone.
Anything less than 30 days.
Okay. Anyone else? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Before I vote, I just want to commend Ms. Dees for all the work that she has done. Some of you have been to a lot of these meetings know that I sometimes come down differently than I'm going to come down on this vote when it comes to these. But the fact that you are professionally understand property, but also that you went the extra mile to take another course on this. This is the first time that I've seen anyone that has gone to this Gantt, I believe is the name of the company, to register for more of our military and government, which has another vetting process on top of it. So I vote aye and just wish that everyone who came here would have gone through the same kind of process that you do.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Good luck.
The next item, number 8, Marcus and Adrian Broom for a conditional use permit to operate short-term rental unit, vacation rental at 9622 20th Bay Street. The purpose of this request is to allow the single-family home to operate as a short-term rental unit.
All right. So 9622 20th Bay Street. This is for a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental vacation rental in a four-bedroom single-family home on the east side of 20th Bay Street between Pleasant Avenue and East Ocean View Avenue in the East Ocean View neighborhood. A short-term rental does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which describes the coastal character district as an eclectic mix of housing types interspersed with neighborhood-scale commercial uses. Property is zoned residential coastal. All short-term rentals in this zone with more than 3 bedrooms are required to have a conditional use permit to operate. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. This house was built in 2017 on a 5,600-square-foot lot. It is compliant with parking requirements, and the applicant will be planting a front yard tree and a backyard tree in order to come more into compliance with the required 20% tree canopy. For other vacation rentals nearby, there are currently 41 vacation short-term rentals and 7 homestay short-term rentals for a total of 48 registered short-term rental parcels in a 1-mile radius. An additional 11 short-term rentals are pending. We're currently tracking 3 additional non-registered short-term rentals in the area. So this property does not have a history of unauthorized short-term rental use. However, in the interest of transparency, there was a complaint that the property was listed online as a short-term rental. The applicant did receive a notice warning of a violation for unauthorized short-term rental use. However, after further consultation with the applicant and the property manager, it was determined that, one, the listing was only visible due to a technical issue. The listing only included the address. I don't even think it was the address. It was just a dot on a map. There were no photos, descriptions, or details about the property. No actual bookings could be made from the listing. No actual bookings were made, and the listing was removed immediately on notification to the property manager that it was there. So within 500 feet, there are currently 5 registered vacation short-term rental parcels and an additional 3 pending short-term rentals. There are no unregistered short-term rentals within 500 feet. For the neighborhood analysis, within 1 mile, approximately 81% of parcels are residential. 1.9%, or 48 of those, are short-term rentals. 81.1% of the parcels within 500 feet are residential, and 3.6%, or 5 of those, are short-term rentals. If all pending and non-registered short-term rentals are included, 2.4% of all residential parcels within 1 mile would be short-term rentals. So since the applicant has owned this property, there have been 3 calls for service to the police and 12 complaints logged into the My Norfolk Resident portal. For calls for service, 1 call was for a disturbance due to loud contractors. Police responded but were not able to locate any loud noises. Second call was due to a vehicle park blocking the sidewalk. Parking enforcement did respond, but there were no notes on whether a violation was written or if a warning was issued to the vehicle's owner. The third call was actually initiated by the applicant to report a neighbor for harassment. In the My Norfolk complaints, 2 complaints were regarding a damaged fence. A violation was issued, but the fence actually belonged to the complainant. The complaint was that the complainant had not been given access to the applicant's yard to fix their fence. 4 complaints were related to a contractor trailer parked in the yard. 2 of those complaints were closed as duplicates. 2 complaints were closed as abated, indicating that they had removed the trailer when the complaint was lodged. 5 complaints were related to improper parking. 2 of those were closed as duplicates. The other 3 were closed without any violations. 1 complaint was regarding a fire pit that was installed in the applicant's backyard. That complaint was closed without violation. Additionally, I was able to get the fire marshal to review the photo provided by the complainant, and he indicated that that everything about it appeared to be legal. So here you can see the share of the comments that we received for this application. Within the 1 mile and 500 feet, we received 89 comments on this application from 76 individuals. Before we get into the recommendation, I'll note this application was delayed a month due to concern raised by neighbors. The applicant did not meet the requirements for their neighborhood meeting. After further review, we determined that the concern was valid and that the applicant was asked to host a second neighborhood meeting. Details can be found in the staff report. There were additional concerns regarding conduct during the second meeting. However, after watching the recorded meeting in its entirety, we believe the applicant conducted the meeting in good faith to the best of their ability and satisfied the meeting requirement. So staff will be recommending approval subject to the conditions. Standard conditions include having emergency contact information provided inside and outside of the property, maintaining a 20-minute response time 24/7, remote entry, security cameras, noise monitors, and private trash pickup. The applicant will plant 2 trees, and there will be a 2-year expiration on the conditional use permit. Any questions?
Thank you, Russell. Questions for Russell? All right, please stand by.
All right.
All right, we have 3 people signed up as the applicant representative who would like to speak. Adrian Brown or Broom.
Okay.
All right. I'm sorry, so we got an order here. Matthew.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's my attorney.
Okay. Since you're the applicant, there's no time. Just need the name and address, and then you both can go back and forth as needed.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Matt Moynihan. I'm counsel for the applicants. Address is 283 Constitution Drive, Suite 520, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23462. I've got the pleasure of introducing Mr. and Mrs. Broom to you guys today for a short-term rental vacation conditional use permit at 9622 20th Bay Street. I'm going to start with a little bit about them. They've invested pretty heavy investment in the city of Norfolk in this property with the intention of using this property as the years progress and they're able to spend more and more time down here as a vacation. They both work remotely, live in Midlothian, and have small children in school, so they're not able to be down here full-time just yet. The plan is as the children get older and there's a little more freedom is to use the property for themselves individually. And so now they're looking to use this property in the interim as a short-term rental. Adrienne fell in love with the area. She went to college in Hampton Roads, was always looking for a way to get back. This opportunity has presented itself and that's why they're here today. Purchased the home in October and have been going through this process since then. I think you can see from some of the staff materials, this has not been the smoothest process for the Brooms. The first meeting that you heard about, that the staff then recommended another one to be held, I believe you'll find that meeting was in good faith, that first one to try to get it done. And through no fault of their own, it wasn't sufficient. They turned around and set another meeting, did that one over Zoom, okay? Plenty of comments were available. You heard from staff that there was a complaint about the tone of how the meeting was held. Fortunately, there was a recording. Staff found no issues with that. I thought it's very commendable that the Brooms have gone through this process. And I think you'll see in a lot of the complaints that are referenced there, you know, I think the commission needs to take a look at whether or not all those complaints were truly brought in good faith through this application process. The sheer number of duplicates alone indicates that there may have been some coordination here to tarnish this application. I will say this, they've gone through this process eyes open. Every time the city has asked them to do something, they have immediately jumped to the task and done it to the best of their ability. I think they'll be a valuable asset to the community. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Adrienne to tell you a little bit more about themselves.
Thank you, Mr. Moynihan. Right, if you don't mind providing your address and then...
Yes, yes. Adrienne Brew, 9622 20th Bay Street, Norfolk, Virginia. Thank you so much, Matt. I've also prepared a statement. You know, first of all, I'd like to recognize, I know you said not to turn around, those here with us today in support of our family vacation home. I also want to thank you all, the City of Norfolk, for allowing us this opportunity. I do not take today and being here lightly at all. A huge part of my memories as a child are filled with the summers spent with my grandparents. Those summers with them are where I learned how to cook. My husband might say I didn't learn too much, but I learned how to play checkers. My grandfather never let me win. Watched the Andy Griffith Show with them before bedtime. And on my favorite days, visited the beach. Those fond memories of this area are what cultivated my desire to go to college at Hampton University. I attended school on a softball scholarship and later went to ODU to pursue my master's degree. I stayed here in the Hampton Roads area after school and began my career in the tech industry. I was offered career advancement opportunities in Richmond and I've been there ever since. So here we are today. The past 2 years with our aging parents and the loss of life of so many around us caused my husband and I to really reflect on our own personal lives and how we wanted to look in our later years. We are fortunate to have been given the opportunity to be hybrid employees and purchase this home with the intent to retire here and for this to be the place where our kids and their kids can enjoy summers and weekends with family. We were intentional about the purchase of this property. We can walk to the beach. We can walk to the fantastic playground and basketball court right down the street on 20th Bay. We have a community center down the street and a backyard for our boys to run and play with our dog. Although we would love to live here full time now, it's not a current reality for us. We are a middle class family and based upon the current levels of interest rates when we purchased, in order to make this future financially happen for us, we must have a short-term rental option. I hope it is clear that we have a genuine love for this community and our intent is to honor the spirit of what it means to be a good neighbor even when some people are not neighborly to us. This home is not in an HOA. However, please understand we have lived in multiple homes with strict HOAs. We have been active in all of them. We understand the importance of abiding by community guidelines in order to maintain the values and safety of all. Furthermore, any issues that have been presented to our family while under the 24-hour surveillance of our neighbors have been quickly resolved or unfounded. We have employed an experienced property manager team that you're going to hear from that has and can quickly handle any issues that arise. Although this experience has tried our faith, I know that the feelings of a few do not encompass all of East Ocean View. We were reminded of this when we recently visited the East Ocean View Community Center down the street from our home, and we were welcomed and reminded of the history of this area and the once-known city beach. At this point, I believe we have done everything in our power to work with our neighbors who are willing to listen and work with us. We are a family just looking to have the opportunity to enjoy a day at the beach when we choose and hopefully pass this home to our boys and future generations when the time comes. I appreciate your consideration today.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Please stand by. We have Sherry Parson also signed up as an applicant, or is she just in support of the application?
Yeah, she's a proponent.
Okay. So the applicant has spoken. Any questions for the applicant while she's here?
I have one question. Yeah. When did you purchase the home? I'm sorry if I missed that.
October.
Thank you.
Great. Is that it? So please stand by.
All right.
Thank you very much. We have a few people signed up in support of this application. The first is the aforementioned Sherry Parson.
Sheree Parson, my address is 9120 Cardiff Road, North Chesterfield, Virginia, 23236. And Mr. Murphy, I'm sorry if I've misspoke on that form there.
Oh, it's okay. It happens all the time.
I'm the proud sister of both Marcus and Adrian, and I am so excited for them this season because they are forward-thinking. They're thinking about their future, aligning with their family vision, which means to have a place where their family can spend vacations and hopefully invite a little of our family members as well, but also thinking about what happens in the next season of their life. The Brooms for us are a model family. They're involved currently in their neighborhood, actually excelling in their professions. They also are committed to a few recreational entities as well as actively serving their local church. They have a reputation and they are known for whatever they touch, they enhance, they enrich, and they make better. They are focused on doing whatever it is to do that enrichment and preserve the best element with a high respect for others. Their investment here in East Ocean View is no different. As a family, we are all excited knowing that we will continue to see them actively do what's necessary to preserve and protect this blessing, this home. In purchasing this home, the Brooms were intentional in their purpose. They did their research. They looked at the process, and they had high hopes that they would, too, be able to use the property as intended. What I like about it is the city of Norfolk actually has a defined process with detailed requirements for homeowners to obtain an approval or a license permit to rent this as a short-term property. This process is important because it aids the community in the best effort to ensure an equitable and fair process in an effort to preserve the values and the interests of this community. The Brooms have embraced this process, respecting what's necessary for the protection of the interests of the community, but also their shared desire to safeguard their neighbors. And yes, there has been quite a bit of opposition, of a few, most with unmerited claims or simply ongoing attacks to undermine their success in this plan. The Brooms have actually dotted every I, crossed every T, with respect to the process as outlined by the City of Norfolk. They've gone far beyond what is necessary to connect with their neighbors and to share their vision and heart about respect for their community. In complying with all of these standards, the Brooms have a reasonable expectation to use this home in a way that meets their family vision. This community will not be disappointed. The Brooms have already proven to be very considerate, conscientious, responsive, to adhere to the process and their commitment to continue in the same fashion. Your vote of yes matters, and it will allow this family to share the best of this neighborhood, it's a beautiful property, with others and their family, and also to follow their plan
That's
in building
your time.
A bright
I'm
future.
Sorry. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Next, as a proponent of this application, Nicole Barnett.
All right. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm Captain Nicole Barnett. My address is 2713 Glennon Drive. And Adrian and Marcus are, Adrian's my sister, Marcus is my brother-in-law. I'm an Army nurse, and my unit actually is at Fort Story, Virginia Beach. And I'm here to advocate for my Army comrades who utilize the Navy Lodge and travel nurses who would love to utilize the Broom's short-term rental. Let me explain why. It's safe, it's convenient access to employment, provides rest, relaxation, and peace of mind when you're away from your family. It's aesthetically pleasing and near the beach. Who wouldn't love that? I have spoken to my fellow comrades, Army comrades, and my nurse colleagues, and they are all excited for the opportunity to stay here. And furthermore, as a family, we are so proud of them. Adrian has already shared with you her reason why. So lastly, what makes a neighborhood? To me, in my opinion, those that are neighborly. As I've traveled and been in and out of locations, my neighbors have been a breath of fresh air. So as lastly, what I would like to say is that I am so excited for them. And just like my sister has said, we are, your vote matters, and we are just so happy for them. And just thank you so much for the opportunity again.
Great, thank you for taking the time to come down. Next, in support of this application, Nicole Pace.
Hi guys, Nicole Pace, 1600 Granby Street, Norfolk, Virginia, 23510. It's good to see you guys again. I'm excited to be representing another house here in Norfolk. As you know, or you may not know, I own Sojourn with my partner, Daniela Kaufman in DC, and we are a professional property management company. We are brokered, licensed, and insured in Virginia. We employ a realtor. And as I've told you guys before, we've been doing this a really long time and had many of these security measures in place. I like to address that part of things, right? We know the Brooms are great people, so this is really more about Sojourn and what we'll do to help facilitate the process here. Of course, we comply with all the camera and the noise monitoring regulations. Those are really important to us too, because I also don't want to be awake dealing with the parties. But I think what sets Sojourn apart over and over again is our partnership with Lloyd's of London and the SuperHog process, which is our fraud and identity check for every guest that stays in a Sojourn. So if you book a Sojourn on Airbnb, on VRBO, on Furnished Finder, through the government, through your hospital, through your insurance company, you are required to go through the SuperHog process with Sojourn, which requires you to upload your ID, verify your credit card, put your credit card on for damages, pay a damage waiver. There's quite a few steps that go on here. So we take a lot of pride that this has eradicated parties and bad actors at Sojourn. We don't have apartments full of smoke in Washington, D.C. anymore. We don't have houses with parties anymore. We just, those people book, they see the process, they cancel, right? I mean, and we also have 24/7 Sojourn employees answering the phone. We don't have a call center. We don't have like somebody on call. We have 24/7 Sojourn employees. So they work directly for us. They know about every house in our portfolio. They're trained for months before they're allowed to go out there on their own. So I just want to make sure you guys understand how serious we take this. It's really important to us. We manage almost 250 properties. We employ a lot of people in Hampton Roads, and we are really excited to continue growing here in Norfolk and Virginia Beach. We're having a really good time doing it despite the opposition. I'm happy to answer any questions about any of those processes we have in place.
Great. Thank you for your comments. Also in support of this application, Star Varela.
I'm just here in support.
Okay. Thank you for coming. Also in support of this application, but does not want to speak, Steve Parson. Thank you. Let's see, all the proponents, the opponents of the application, We have one who signed up to speak, Aradia Robertson.
Aradia Robertson, 9620 20th Bay Street. I live right next door to the house that Mr. and Mrs. Broom bought. At the initial neighborhood meeting at COVA, it did not go well at all. Like I said, the neighborhood meetings don't work. There's no one to mediate them. There's no one to structure them. I could see it in their eyes that they have never felt that hurt, both them and Misty's, that they have never felt so attacked by residents before who were opposing this. At the neighborhood meeting, the Brooms also listed people who were in attendance who were not, among them Tommy Smeagol and Dr. Phil Smith. We were actually kicked out of COVA for the meeting. Over the time that they have had it, there's been numerous reports and complaints by neighbors. I have a saying that if one person is complaining, they could be the problem. If many people are complaining, there is a problem. You have several neighbors that have made complaints on the same issue. They parked a trailer in the grass. It was a code violation. They were issued a violation. It was abated. They parked another trailer in the grass. They had their contractor was using a neighbor's parking, assigned spaces to park in and coming across the street. This happened many times. It's also my understanding that an STR inspector was sent out on a property that wasn't even an STR yet. All of the complaints, the kids were throwing rocks at moving cars. And then I also sent in video of the kids throwing rocks again, not at moving cars, but they almost hit my car. We've had construction noise going until 11 o'clock at night. I do not call the police unless I have actual video of something that I can back it up with. It is not the Brooms that people don't like. It's the business. The Brooms themselves are a very lovely couple. I would be blessed to live next door on a regular basis, but they're not living next door. It's going to be a business that is not wanted by our community. The only two local people that are in support of this are an address, let's see, Tawana Wilson, 9558 20th Bay Street. That's an STR. They live in Maryland. Catherine and Daniel Coates, 9569 20th Bay Street. You're going to see them on the agenda in February to STR their house. You have no local people who support this at all, but you have many neighbors that are in opposition to this. And again, it's not the Brooms that they don't want, it's the business. I've been through STRs before. I've lived next door. This exact address was an STR not that long ago that was shut down in court because it was so bad. Our back decks are on the second floor. It's above the fence line. Our back decks face each other. Our front decks are right next to each other.
Thank you.
I couldn't do this in 3 minutes, sorry.
Also signed up in opposition of this application, but does not wish to speak, Ellen M. Miller. Thank you. James A. Miller. Thank you. Laura Reese. Thank you. And Joan Ernest. Thank you. That's everyone who signed up to speak or be acknowledged. So now we enter the rebuttal period. 5 minutes for the applicant. So that can be Ms. Broom or Mr. Monahan to speak to address any of the issues or make additional points. And then 5 minutes of the opposition. So if you have anything to add, you have 5 minutes.
Sure. I won't take too much more of your time. You know, we just ask you to look at the packet of information that's been developed for you guys in reviewing this. All of the information you guys need to make an informed decision about the property is in there. You heard from the Brooms. You heard about their vision. You heard from the property manager. They're going to have somebody here to abate any issues that come up. You heard about the complaints. You heard from Mr. Manning about the number of complaints that were duplicates. And you heard that of those, there was one that was issued, and it was for a contractor parking issue. So as you're going through and you're going to vote here, I'd ask that you know, keep in mind the information that's in the packets. It's been a lot that's been generated, and we look forward to seeing the results of the vote. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Ms. Broom, do you have anything to add?
Just so I would say that, first of all, I'd like to, I thank Ms. Robertson for acknowledging the level of things that we've gone through as far as these meetings. It is definitely something I've never experienced. I will say that, you know, I have empathy for her. My mother passed away in November, and one of the last things I talked to her about, you know, was this situation. She said, you know, just pray for peace, for peace of mind for your neighbor. And, you know, I acknowledged for a long time that she was a single female living in that home with her older son. And, you know, I took that in, you know, to consideration that, you know, that, you know, that's why, you know, she's been calling the police and things like that as far as our family. But then her husband returned, and he's been there since November. And I would just ask for someone that has just experienced someone losing my mother, that she realize that there's so much involved as far as life and the importance of family and spending time with your loved ones, because I feel like the attention and everything that she's put our family through has taken herself away from her home and the realities of those. And the 10 cameras in front of her house and constantly watching for the things that, you know, we're doing and how we're enjoying our life, it cannot be a happy life when you're doing that. You're seeking out things versus just living in peace. So I just ask for peace of mind for her.
Thank you. Ms. Robertson, you have a 5 minutes rebuttal period.
It's wonderful to have people praying for you. That is actually the highest compliment that you can get from somebody. I also wanted to bring up with some of the problems with Sojourn. Right now, every single STR from 15th Bay to 21st Bay all has recently had some kind of code violation or STR violation, including the ones that Sojourn is managing. And on top of those, these are also printouts from Sojourn's website for different listings: a three-bedroom unit, 8 guests; one-bedroom, 4 guests; two-bedroom, 5 guests; two-bedroom, 5 guests; two-bedroom, 5 guests. They're all over legal occupancy. Every single Sojourn property on 20th Bay, 17th Bay, 17th Bay. Again, code violations for trash, parking on the lawn. Another thing is, no matter what is going on with our neighbors, I mean, we're a very close-knit neighborhood. Every single one of our neighbors that have moved in, we have all signed a welcome card to them and gave them a gift when they moved in. Every single neighbor that moves out, we give a card to them and a gift as they go. The Brooms were the first ones that wasn't done, because it was the business that they didn't want in the neighborhood. And as we were even looking for a fugitive, I had told her, I don't care how mad you are at me, if you spot this individual, you need to tell me. Her safety was our priority as well. No matter what's going on with STRs, safety is a priority. And that's also why we recently had a meeting with Councilwoman McClellan and the owner of Tesseract, because of some problems that involved that too. No matter what, we put our STR issues aside, and crime was the primary focus. I'm glad she mentioned my husband came back. He's been active duty for 34 years, has a security clearance, and this is an issue, having an STR next to us that anybody could rent, no background checks, anything like that. More so known than STRs, I'm known for the crime in the area and battling the crime in the area. And I was in court this morning trying to keep someone in jail from a bond hearing, from getting out on bond with 17 charges, including hitting 2 officers with his car the last time he fled. This is also a risk for me. Cola Beals is a recent story that had murdered 3 people, 2 in Virginia Beach, 1 in Norfolk, and he was found by marshals at an STR. The property on 17th Bay at 9639, the same individual I was trying to keep in jail, was using this property for nefarious purposes. So this is also a security risk to me and my husband as well. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, that's the end of the rebuttal period. Commissioners, any comments or questions?
Yes, I have two comments.
Okay.
To Ms. Robertson, you spend a great deal of time on what you do. You have mentioned a number of times that the process with the meetings does not work. I would like to ask, how much time have you put into making the process work? Because that's what is there to help to make sure that the people and the place are going to work in this situation, because we have STRs for a variety of reasons, and we have stated very clearly we are putting a great deal of effort into making it work for the community. We're ultimately concerned about strong neighborhoods, and that there's housing for all people in Norfolk, affordable housing. I'm impressed that the family, that this is a family enterprise, and that in the long run, they are going to live there. It's not something which they look upon as a business prize long-term into the future. Also, you list a number of situations in which that have troubled you and others around you. We're looking at each specific situation for how it will affect the area. And one must be dispassionate in terms of not painting everyone with the same brush, because it is a community, it is relationships, and those relationships need to go forward to be as strong as possible to make the neighborhood as safe as possible. The boroughs appear to be one of those instances in which they truly have an investment in the area. So how is that getting communicated? How is that being responded to in a process that is said to be from one perspective that it doesn't work, and how much effort is being put in to make it work? That's it.
Thank you. Commissioners, any other comments, questions of the applicant? Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permit subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
No.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I will make that recommendation to City Council. Good luck.
Okay, item number 11, Marriott Residence Inn. For the following conditional use permits at 1590 North Military Highway: A, for a banquet hall; B, live entertainment; C, the sale of alcoholic beverages on premises. The purpose of these requests is to allow for the operation of a banquet hall with live entertainment and alcoholic beverages for on-premise consumption.
Good afternoon again, Commissioners. This site is located on the east side of North Military Highway near the intersection with Norview Avenue. The proposed conditional use permit is consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates this site as commercial. I guess let's keep going. The property is currently zoned office, and the conditional use permit is for a banquet hall, live entertainment, and sale of alcoholic beverages on premise. This operator has been operating since 2004, but it's under new ownership. So with the new ownership, they need a new conditional use permit. And I'm going to go over some here's a picture of the site. I'm about to go over some of the changes between the prior operation and this one. They're minor. So the previous hours of operation were 7 a.m. till 2 a.m. Monday through Saturday, and 10 a.m. until 2 a.m. on Sunday. The proposed hours of operation will be 7 a.m. till midnight, 7 days a week. The hours for sale of alcoholic beverages was 11 a.m. until 2 a.m. 7 days a week. The proposed is 7 a.m. until 12 o'clock midnight 7 days a week. And this is mostly to accommodate the boutique shop that they have that sells alcohol to guests of the hotel, as well as for room service sales. The previous occupancy was 400 total capacity. The current, the proposed occupancy is 150 seats indoors, 200 standing room, four employees for a total of 354. And the entertainment forms of disc jockey and live band will remain the same. Staff recommend that the application be approved subject to the conditions in the staff report. The site is operated as an entertainment establishment since 2004 and will continue to operate in conduct similar operations. Let's do my friend questions.
Questions? Thank you. Please stand by. So we have two people signed up as the applicant representative. Richard Murphy, no relationship.
Richard Murphy, 2401 Hillcrest Meadows Lane, Virginia Beach. I'm just here if you guys have any questions for me. As mentioned, it's nothing's changing with the operation except for sometimes we're reducing the hours. Most of the use with the beer and wine sales is through what we call the market, like a vending area for guests of the hotel to grab. And occasionally we'll have events where we would have a bartender selling beer and wine only.
Got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Stand by. Also signed up to speak as the applicant representative, Robin Thomas, available to answer questions. Does anyone have any questions of Ms. Thomas? Welcome. Okay, we'll make a note of that, so I know which one that goes to. All right, so no one else has signed up to speak on this application. Commissioners, any questions or comments? Please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the conditional use permits subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. We'll make a recommendation to City Council. Before we move on, Susan, Robin, are you here for the
Butter
restaurant?
Butter Mills, I think. Butter Mills.
Butter Mills? Thank you.
Got it.
Let's go.
Okay. Item number 12, Teco and Tequila for the following conditional use permits at 1421 Colley Avenue. A, the sale of alcoholic beverages on premise, and B, the sale of alcoholic beverage off premise. The purpose of these requests is to allow for the restaurant to sell alcoholic beverages for both on and off premise. Okay, Taco and Tequila, 1421 Colley Avenue, located on the southwest corner of Shirley Avenue and Colley Avenue. It is the old Red Dog Saloon. We have a new operator there, and they are pretty much eliminating all of the floor plan from before and doing a whole new floor plan required them to get a new conditional use permit. Again, as of September of 2020, all restaurants serving alcohol need a conditional use permit. They fall under this category. They are in a CC zoning, but they are also in the PCO Colley, which is the pedestrian commercial overlay on Colley Avenue. And again, new restaurant, and they want to sell alcohol for both on and off premise. That is a photo there. You can see they're maintaining the outdoor dining. Brand new floor plan, which I'll have in the next slide. Since it was a grandfathered site before, we don't exactly know what their hours are, but these are going to be their new hours, probably fairly similar to what they were before, 11 to 10 Monday through Thursday, and 11 to 11 Friday through Sunday. Capacity probably about the same, 178 seats indoors, 38 seats outdoors, and 227 total capacity. And that is their brand new floor plan. Staff is recommending approval. Again, this is the exact type of use that we want on Colley Avenue. There is residential fairly close, but with the hours and no entertainment, this should not have a negative impact on the neighborhood.
Thank you for that. Any questions of Susan? Please stand by.
Oh, and I want to add one thing. They are working with Public Works with Frieda Burns on getting some additional bike parking. The discussion was probably better on Shirley than Collie, a little crowded on Collie, so Shirley would be the better location.
Great, thank you. We have the applicant representative signed up to speak, Chris Arney.
I'm right here. I'm available for any questions.
I've got one.
Okay.
You bring the samples.
If you don't mind stating your name and mailing address from the podium.
Chris Arney, 1421 Collie Avenue.
Great. So what is your experience in operating restaurants?
Me? I don't have any. My partners do. My partners own quite a few restaurants in Virginia and other areas. Pennsylvania. Tacos Tequila is a brand in Pennsylvania.
It is.
They have four in Pennsylvania, and we're going to bring that brand here.
Great. Didn't realize that. Thanks. That answers my question. Okay. Any other questions for the applicant? Appreciate you joining us today.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. No one signed up to speak against this application. So unless the commissioners have comments or questions, we're going to call the vote. Susan?
The motion is to recommend approval subject to the conditions contained in the staff report. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. We'll make that recommendation to City Council. Good luck.
Okay. On to new business. The first item, Rudder Mills Law Firm for Development Certificate with waivers at 160 West Brambleton Avenue and 708, 710, 712, and 714 Bush Street. Okay, Rudder Mills Law Firm, and it's not 106, it's 160 West Brambleton Avenue. This request is for a development certificate. It is the Rudder Mills Law Firm is in existence. They've been at that location since 2003. They are proposing to construct an addition on the rear of the building, and they would need a development certificate to do that. That's a photo of the building now. Where the building is going is in that parking lot that you see. And I mentioned earlier the wall. That's the little wall that I was talking about that kind of goes along with the building when the building was built. So again, they are here for a development certificate. The building was built in 1950. They've been there since 2003. The addition is approximately 4,789 square feet. It contains restrooms. There's parking on the first floor. There's outdoor space and then office space on that second floor. In the DAD district, so it's the Downtown Arts District, they are required to get a development certificate for any new development. That requires review by the Architectural Review Board and the Planning Commission, and if there are waivers required, it goes on to City Council. The first part of that was the Architectural Review Board, and I'm going to have Susan discuss that aspect with you.
Thank you, Susan. Good afternoon. This building is in the Norfolk Otero State National Historic District. The primary building for which the addition is going to be done at 160 Brambleton Avenue, also known today as Rudder Mills Law Firm. Susan said it's a circa 1950 building, colonial revival style. It's a two-story building. It does contribute to the historic district. The building on the other side on Bush Street, adjacent to the addition, is 720 Bush Street, WTKR. That's a 1949 building. That's in the modern style. It's a four-story building. It's also contributing. So I think what's really important about this site is how do you make it fit into a really mid-century neighborhood where the primary building is a colonial revival, and I think they've done a nice job with this. So it's linking kind of a two-story and a four-story building, and really it's a second floor addition, not a two-story addition. So in this first slide, you'll see, if you can see the that doesn't work, the green box kind of around through some of the parking spaces. That's the footprint of the proposed building, and there's two lines going to it from the primary building, and that's going to be where the bridge or the connecting hallway
anticipated to be. I think what's really important here is Susan pointed out the original parapet wall or planters. I think they really contribute to that street line, and the addition is very sensitive to leaving it there. It kind of makes it float or kind of fade in, if you will, which I hate to say that because it's a very elegant addition. So the floor plan is on this slide. So above the parking, probably two-thirds of it, maybe to half, is the interior space, which is the light gray area towards the top of the screen. And the darker gray area is going to be outdoor space. The bridge between the addition and the primary structure is also where the restrooms and the water fountains are going to be. So this is the roof plan. I think what's interesting about this is the dark gray part is the roof over the enclosed area. This is not taller than the primary structure. It is a flat roof. The band, the whitish gray band, is actually a canopy that transitions between the indoor-outdoor space. And then the kind of the vertical line piece going across the front is a trellis, so it gives it some sort of screening depending on the time of day. Nice transition, kind of a shade for the inside. So this is a conceptual rendering of the finished product. The materials are complementary. What you can't see here is they're going to use a sand finish IFIS that matches as close as possible to the mortar on the primary building, which really is a very nice tie-in. It has a storefront for transparency. It's very, although you can't really see it here because there's a structure that comes out that gives you the illusion that it's an enclosed building, but it's a lot of open space. So they have a lot of nice planting area. They're also using a type of panel that's going to be quite lovely in the dark gray parts on the facade. So I have more information on that if you're interested. These were earlier conceptual drawings, but what I thought was important about them is that you have a better view of how transparent and how open the proposal is. And I bring that up because the ARB was very complimentary of this addition. One thing they said is to keep it as light an airy as possible. I think that the applicant has achieved it. I would say, from my opinion, the design is an excellent example of what we want to see and meets the spirit. When we have to do a waiver, we want a design that's really works with the site and is very complementary. And so the ARB did 100% or unanimously agreed to make the recommendation as they presented it. And I know that Robin Thomas is here for the applicant if you have any questions.
Great. Thank you, Susan. Anyone have questions for Susan while she's at the mic? Thank you very much.
Okay, so back to the development certificate. So the project will have to comply with all of the standards in the zoning ordinance. However, with a development certificate, there are certain things you can waive: the building placement, the off-street parking, and the requirements for the use of ground floor areas. So as far as the building placement, in the DAD district, the arts district, 75% of each facade, and that's the facades along Bush and Brambleton, 75% of those facades should be on the property line. The building meets it on Brambleton, but on Bush Street, the existing building is actually only about 9 feet back, and then the addition is about 34 feet back. So they will be required to get a waiver for that. For parking, there is no parking required, so they don't need a waiver for that. For the required use of the ground floor, we have a certain set of active or commercial uses that would be required. This site is actually in a flood zone, so we always go to the first habitable floor, and the first habitable floor is office space. So they comply with the required use of the ground floor. So staff is recommending that the application be approved, subject to the necessary waiver for the building setback. Any questions that I can answer?
Thank you. Questions? The architect is here if anyone has any questions about the design. Jeremy, was there anything you wanted to add from ARB's perspective?
No, nothing to add other than what Susan said. They were unanimously supporting and very complimentary.
Great. I'll add, I commend the applicant and the architect for doing something that you would normally find on a pedestrian-friendly street. And maybe this will be something that stimulates others to take action to create that better pedestrian experience, because it's an important block that could link other parts of the greater downtown area. But you feel like you're out of place if you're on your feet or on a bike at this point. So I appreciate them doing something that is not the norm on that street and might affect positive change. Susan, please call the vote.
The motion is to recommend approval of the development certificate subject to the necessary waivers. Waiver. Ms. Austin?
I second what our chair has said, and I say yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Yeah, I'll also add the thoughtfulness of preserving the view of that mural on the side of the building, I think makes it really, really nice. So thank you. I vote yes also.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. Thank you.
The next item on the new business, initiate an amendment to the Norfolk Zoning Ordinance to address outdoor dining on private property.
So as we discussed earlier, there's a process going on to evaluate how we're going to move forward with outdoor dining in the post-COVID world. The approvals that are in place now in the city expire in the end of March, so we're working through some processes in code to make sure we can accommodate kind of what we've learned over the last couple of years about outdoor dining and how it can work. There is a public process being run by WPA that's public meetings the next couple of weeks, so hopefully people can get out and attend those. And otherwise, I'm here for questions.
Big questions.
Could I clarify, they expire the end of April?
End of April, sorry. A little more time for us.
Please call the vote.
The motion is to initiate the text amendment. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Mr. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
I vote aye. Thank you.
And then item number three on new business, initiate amendments to the RC zoning district to permit additional retail and office uses.
So we've had a request from really two property owners or potential property owners of what outwardly appear to be commercial properties in Oceanview along Oceanview Avenue, but in the RC zoning district, that are looking at potentially adaptive reuse or just reuse of some of these spaces. That are not permitted with uses that are not permitted under the RC zoning district, such as an office type of use. So we haven't given it too much thought, but the idea of potentially allowing additional commercial uses in RC, maybe limiting it to along Oceanview Avenue or Shore Drive or something like that, could be an appropriate thing, requiring a conditional use permit or requiring compliance with a pattern book. Something like that could be something that we need to dive into. We're not hurrying into this. We don't want to hurry into this. There are several civic leagues out there that I'm sure would want to have input on this that we should speak to. So, but we do think it's something worth at least exploring.
I concur. Commissioners, any comments on this? I said upstairs, I'll say it publicly, go far as you can on the mixed use. Norfolk's healthiest neighborhoods are those that are mixed use. Susan?
The motion is to initiate the amendments to the RC zoning district. Ms. Austin?
Yes.
Ms. Shelton?
Yes.
Mr. Bateman?
Aye.
Mr. McGee?
Aye.
Mr. Pendleton?
Aye.
Ms. Sutter?
Aye.
And Mr. Murphy?
Aye. Thank you. That appears to be the end of our agenda. Mr. Melita, do you have anything today?
No, Mr. Chair.
Interim Director Shea, do you have anything?
No, thank you.
Ms. Pollack? All right, we're adjourned. Thank you.